Hey guys, this is Captain Cross here, and today we've got our hands on one of the very first retail units of the new NVIDIA RTX 2080. Let's check them out. So for today we have Asus RTX 2080 and NVIDIA Founders Edition. First of all, we are going to unbox the Asus RTX 2080. And please pardon my camera skills here. I was trying to handle the camera with one hand. It kept falling off like a new cameraman that I am. So this is the retail box. If you buy a Asus RTX 2080, this is what you're going to get. Opening the box. Oh yeah, I forgot to tell you that the GPU is already put in a system for showing us demos. This is the driver CD, which nobody will use, a manual that nobody would use, and here is going to be the GPU, but it's not because it's in a system. So let me get the GPU and I'll show you the GPU directly. So this is the Asus RTX 2080 ray tracing. You can see the branding here, and 16 pin and 18 pin power connector. No HDMI in front for VR, I'll tell you why, and a huge heatsink for heat dissipation, and really sexy backplate, and lot of connectors with a type C that I will tell you why it's there later in the video. And this is the fancy new NVLink that we will talk about later. It has a higher bandwidth, but it has a lot of features up its sleeve. It was surprisingly light for some reason. I'm not sure why, but maybe the Strix version would be here. Moving on to some game demos. This is the Epic Infiltrator running at 4K with G-Sync on, RTX off, and deep learning super sampling was switched off. I'm sorry, I forgot to ask them to record it directly, so we have to suffice with this footage right now. Now, coming to RTX, yes, we all know it's not a cheap card, coming at $800 for 2080 and $1200 for 2080 Ti. But you have to consider the fact that it has been made with 4K gaming and professional grade workload kept in mind. It works on a new Turing architecture which has been in development for more than 10 years in NVIDIA's labs. It uses the 12 nanometer architecture, runs on a GDDR6 VRAM. Now the fun part, it uses 25% of the chip area dedicated to tensor cores and another 25% dedicated to the ray tracing cores. Now the NVLink, it is going to be amazing because it has a higher bandwidth than SLI, and SLI has completely been removed. It allows VRAM stacking and mesh networking, so 2080 8GB would make 1 2080 16GB. There is no issues there now. Now RTX also supports virtual link, which means type C can provide power, video and data over type C for VR. So no more 3 cables and that kind of stuff, and also supports pure video, which is video decoding directly on chip instead of being on software. Pure video supports edge enhancements, noise reduction, deinterlacing, dynamic contrast enhancement and color enhancement. Now for our streamer friends out there, the RTX also has a special thing for you. It has better NVENC performance for streamers. Now this has been shown by many YouTubers already, but I thought it is something worth mentioning. Now I mentioned tensor cores. Tensor cores are amazing, to be honest, because they allow the artificial intelligence to run directly on the hardware instead of mimicking it through the software. Now what are tensor cores going to help for the gamers? Well, it is going to be amazing with the upcoming technologies that NVIDIA is working for. And let me just change the demos here. So demo has come to Final Fantasy 15. The RTX is off, but DLSS is now on. It is running on 4K. I'm not sure about G-Sync though. So Tensor cores will allow better cheat detection systems. So yeah, a lot better cheat detection systems. It will allow the Tensor cores to handle the character animation and physics much better. So, you know, I think better hair works. It will enable devs to make boss fights that are not scripted and can adapt to a player's fight style. That means the longer you fight an enemy, the harder it's gonna get, dude. Come on, gonna do that in first shit. Okay, yeah. So yeah, it also supports better text to speech in games, so NPCs won't sound robotic like they used to. Accelerated speech recognition and neural machine translation is supported by the Tensor cores. Coming to DLSS, which the Final Fantasy is running right now, but you can't really see it, you have to see it a bit closely. What really is DLSS? It's not a gimmick, well, first of all. So DLSS is deep learning super sampling. It can be integrated to any modern game engine, so any upcoming games will come with DLSS. With these games that are already enabled with DLSS, what DLSS does is, well, a supercomputer at NVIDIA Labs trains these Tensor cores with the pre-release of the games. Now these trained Tensor cores are now integrated into the new drivers and sent to the consumer. When you install the drivers, it will basically train Tensor cores on your RTX card as well. So now your RTX cards Tensor cores know how to do DLSS, or whatever the black magic they are doing under the fans. DLSS also includes super samplings, as it says in the name, so it renders your game on increased resolution than being played on. If you're playing on 1080p, it is going to render on 1440p or maybe even 2K, and then scale it down to 1080p, so it looks much better. A lot of details are increased, and that will give you better photorealistic images and crisper edges. Now you might have noticed that I'm only showing you demos here right now. This is because Microsoft has not released the DirectX DXR support yet. It will be released by October 9th, so it would be fun to see. But till then, we can't really use our ray tracing on games unless they release it before October 9th. So, well, I would like to mention something that a lot of people are not mentioning, is that there is no complete ray tracing. Ray tracing is there, yes. It's not a gimmick, yes, sure. But it's not complete ray tracing when rendering a game, especially a fast-paced shooter like Battlefield or maybe even Call of Duty, the upcoming Call of Duty, if it allows ray tracing. Ray tracing will be used alongside rasterization. Rasterization will be used for major rendering, and then ray tracing will be used to produce reflections, refractions, and shadows. So ray tracing will be replacing the older raster techniques such as cube maps and depth maps, so it will produce more photorealistic images. Coming to performance, ray tracing was available on Pascal, which is the 10th series cards, but it was not good enough. The performance has now been increased up to 8 to 10 times over 10th gen. So the guys with 3D workloads and the architectures, you are going to have great time with these cards. I talked to some people who do architecture and 3D rendering work, and they said they are really liking the new cards. NVIDIA also has this new thing called NVIDIA NGX, which is AI-based acceleration. It will allow us for better image editing with the help of artificial intelligence, as well as better slow-mo videos with artificial intelligence. AI UpRes will help you increase resolution of an image by making new pixels instead of stretching the old ones. Turing also allows Microsoft DXR Optics Vulkan for access to ray tracing. So here is the Founders Edition RTX 2080 we've got here. And first of all, a huge shout out to Mass Computers at Nehru Place, Delhi. If you want to buy the RTX card or any gaming related product or a gaming machine, I would highly suggest them because they provide on-site warranty for your products if you live in Delhi, that is. They also plan to ship all over India soon, so that would be great. I'll leave the link down in the description so you can check them out. You see the branding, 6+8 pin power, no HDMI because USB Type-C, a great backplate though, and a lot, oh, you see the USB Type-C there. And let me take out the accessories here. So as you might have seen, there is no DVI, so they have included a HDMI to DVI cable. And this here is some paperwork that you get. Okay, you see me struggling there. I'm not that, okay, yes I am that clumsy, okay. Okay, so a guide and support guide, which nobody is going to read as usual. And let me close this up so that others can check this out as well. You know, everyone has to shoot videos. I'm not that special snowflake that gets to do everything by himself. So the new the new card design is so much better than older blower card design, and people that have used this for a few days now have told me that the thermals are so much better than blower style cards. And surprisingly, the card was heavier than the Asus card for some reason. I'm not sure though. You see the Type-C on the end? That will be used for VR. That is going to be amazing, to be honest. So let me put this back in. So verdict, well, it's not really worth upgrading if you are the average 1080p gamer. It is worth upgrading if you are into 3D rendering, or if you are upgrading to 4K gameplay, or if you already play on 4K. But I would like to say it is worth adding extra money if you're making a new PC. That was it, guys. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, please like, subscribe, share it with your friends, all that good stuff. All the important links are in the description. Check them out and keep gaming.